We've just studied these lateral modes, and out of those lateral modes, the Dutch roll mode is usually the mode that causes the most problems in aircraft design. So the roll mode is usually heavily damped, really not an issue because of the large wingspan. The spiral mode can be a little tricky. You want it to be convergent, or sometimes it's just slightly divergent. And that's okay as long as the doubling time isn't too fast, and the pilot or the autopilot are going to automatically correct for that. So that's not too much of an issue usually. But the Dutch roll mode, the problem with the Dutch roll mode is that it's an oscillatory mode. So let's just draw this out here again. So the Dutch roll mode is an oscillatory mode, and hopefully it's convergent, but the period of this mode, if you were to look at the distance between peaks, is on the order of about 2 to 10 seconds, and if it's closer to the 2 seconds, then that means it's on the order of pilot response time, and so pilots can actually respond to this in non-helpful ways, and we'll talk about that actually in a subsequent video. But what we want to talk about here is how do we manage or how do we change the Dutch roll mode? How do we design the aircraft so that we can tune the Dutch roll mode to something that is useful to a pilot? So let's look at the influence of both roll and yaw. Stability and damping. So the Dutch roll mode is sensitive to how much roll stability we have, how much yaw stability we have, how much roll damping we have, and how much yaw damping we have. Okay, so we're going to look at all four of these, and we're also going to look at their effects on the spiral mode. Okay, so if we increase roll stability, that will decrease the Dutch roll damping. Damping is we actually want to increase Dutch roll damping. Okay, so increasing roll stability here in this first box here, we're going to look at just increasing roll stability. That decreases the Dutch roll damping, and it increases the spiral damping. So increasing spiral damping is a good thing. Decreasing Dutch roll damping is a bad thing. Okay, we want to increase the damping of both. If we increase yaw stability, that will increase the Dutch roll damping. So that's a good thing. But unfortunately, that decreases the spiral damping. Okay, if we increase the roll damping, then that helps with the Dutch roll, so that increases the Dutch roll damping, but it decreases the spiral damping. And then finally, if we increase yaw damping, that increases the Dutch roll damping and increases the spiral damping. Okay, so this is the quadrant that we want to play with here. Because increasing yaw damping is beneficial for both the Dutch roll and the spiral mode. If you look at any of the other combinations of roll stability and roll stability, roll damping, or yaw stability, any of these other three quadrants here, if you increase that parameter, say roll stability, you're going to help one of those modes but hurt the other mode. So you can see these arrows are going in the opposite directions in each of these quadrants. So we're helping one mode, but we're hurting another mode. This is the only parameter here, this yaw damping, that helps both the Dutch roll and the spiral. So naturally, we want to be able to control the yaw damping. Yaw damping is something that's very important on an aircraft because that is going to allow us to control or manage both the Dutch roll and the spiral modes. Okay, so how would we do this? Well, let's look at a geometric approach here. So what if we had to What if we wanted to control the yaw damping just straight up with the geometry of the aircraft, you know, how we have designed this aircraft? So let's look at this airplane from the side. Here's our center of gravity. And if we add a vertical stabilizer, now I'm going to have the aircraft traveling in this direction here so that the free stream velocity is coming in from over here. So we got V infinity. So we add a vertical stabilizer. Usually those are in the back. So I'm going to draw some vertical stabilizer back here. Now the purpose that the reason we put that there is just for what we said. It's a vertical stabilizer that's giving us yaw stability, right? So so by putting a stabilizer back there, that increases yaw stability. Okay, that also actually creates some yaw damping, okay? So that that produces some yaw damping by having that vertical stabilizer there. Well, it turns out if we put a vertical surface in front of the center of gravity, so I'm just going to draw another vertical surface out here, that actually a surface in front of the CG is destabilizing. So having that surface there would actually decrease the yaw stability, but it actually increases the yaw damping. So remember that damping is when the aircraft opposes a rate about that axis. So if we were to look at this from the top, so let's look at this aircraft from the top. And so there's our center of gravity, and then we've got a vertical surface there and a vertical surface there. What happens is our yawing rate is positive in this direction. So let's say we've got some rotation rate R, that's our yaw rate. And what happens is due to the change in lift on each of these surfaces, that actually increases. Let's look at the surface back here. So by rotating the aircraft there to the right, we're going to increase the lift on this side of the aircraft. So we'll just put kind of a bubble right there so that we'll be getting some lift on that side. And then we can see if we look at the, because this is rotating to the right here, that's going to produce some lift in this direction. So we'll put a bubble on that side, so we've got some lift there. So you can see that that creates a moment that actually opposes, so we'll draw this opposing moment N. N is our yawing moment. So that creates a moment that opposes that rotation. So damping is usually negative. So our damping derivative, our yaw damping derivative, would be the change in N with respect to R. Or we usually call that CN R bar in non-dimensional form. So CN R bar is usually negative, right? That's our yaw stability derivative. So it's usually less than zero. And by adding a surface in front or behind the CG, we increase the magnitude of that yaw damping. Okay, so that becomes more negative. We can do that one of two ways. We can by adding these surfaces here, we can increase it by sliding that surface back. So it's related to the distance away from the center of gravity. So we could slide that surface back. That will increase the damping. We can also increase the size of these surfaces. That will also increase the damping. So by playing with the location and the size of these two surfaces, we can actually control both yaw stability and yaw damping, because the yaw stability increases with the one in the back and decreases with the one in the front, where yaw damping increases for both of those, right? If we add area or length to both of those. So by adjusting the area and the length of both of these vertical surfaces, we could actually create an aircraft with any combination of yaw stability and yaw damping that we want. Now, this turns out to be not a very helpful way to manage this, and that's because by adding this surface in the front, we're actually increasing the drag on the aircraft. So we don't just want to add vertical surfaces unless we absolutely have to, and adding a surface in the front just to increase yaw damping also increases the drag, and it can also cause some issues for pilot view, you know, their field of view, things like that. So anyway, this isn't something that we see very often. We usually do not solve this yaw damping problem or try to control yaw damping strictly from geometry. Usually what we do is, or at least on most modern aircraft, what they have is what's called a yaw damper. And what they do is they put a gyroscope on the aircraft that measures the yawing rate. And then they link the deflection of the rudder. So if we just look at from the top down version of this, so we've got some rudder deflection here, delta R. They say that our rudder deflection is going to be equal to the rudder deflection that the pilot is putting in, plus some gain, we'll just call it K1, times the yawing rate, R. So they've got a gyroscope on board the aircraft that is deflecting the rudder proportional to the yawing rate of the aircraft. And so what that does is by changing the deflection here, they're artificially making this lift here on the horizontal greater, or changing the magnitude here of that lift proportional to the rotation rate. And so in that way, they're kind of mimicking if they had another surface up here that would naturally be doing that, but they can they do that manually or automatically through this yaw damper, as it's called. So this is kind of a control system. Now they can also add, it can also adjust this if they want to give any yaw stability derivative that they want. So they can change the yaw stability by simply adding another term here. So we'll call it K2, another gain that's proportional to the aerodynamic angle beta. So so this R would be getting measured by some gyro on board the aircraft, and this beta is an aerodynamic angle. That there are different ways to measure that on an aircraft. So so if they know their rotation rate and their beta, they can choose these two gain values, K1 and K2, to actually give any yaw damping derivative or yaw stability derivative that they want. And so this is a control system built into the aircraft. On most modern aircraft, you have something like this, and it's called a yaw damper. So this is why yaw dampers are very important, and mostly it's tied to this Dutch roll mode, the fact that we want to be able to control the Dutch roll mode. But we can't, it's kind of challenging to just control it by changing our roll stability or yaw stability or roll damping derivatives, because when you increase those, you're either helping or hurting either the Dutch roll or the spiral mode in every case. The only one that helps both is, again, this yaw damping derivative. And so that's why the yaw damper is such a common thing on modern aircraft.